I will be talking about how to construct a magnetic loop antenna. And just so you know, I've never done anything like this before. I've done dipoles and verticals, and maybe loader verticals, but none of them have been very successful. I mean, they work to some degree, but not too successful, which is the reason why I'm doing this magnetic loop antenna. For those of you who don't know, a magnetic loop antenna is an antenna that looks like a loop. It's a loop of wire, and this is not connected to our small loop over here, which is connected to our transmitter. And at the top, we're going to have a variable capacitor of some sort to tune from the lower bands to the higher bands on HF. The magnetic loop antenna is supposed to be a very good antenna for tuning a wide range of frequencies, but it has a very, very narrow bandwidth for each segment you tune to. So you need this variable capacitor here, which I've just put together, and I'll be talking through step by step how this came about. Okay, so right now I'm only going to focus on this variable capacitor and how it's built, because it is one of the most important elements of a magnetic loop antenna. So really, this construction is rather simple. You only have to figure out how to cut these plates the right size. And I just put this together with a couple of threaded rods and nuts, and that is really it. There's nothing too complex about this. So how I did this was that first, you know, I found two end plates. These are just scrap plastic pieces that I happen to have around. I cut them to a rectangular shape. Now maybe you might want to make this bigger to kind of cover the top of this also, but you know, this is fine. Just so you can have your threaded rods fit in there, and this, you know, this one is pretty close to the top, but it works. This is just about the right size for me. I went through a couple of designs. So I had, you know, you would see these butterfly-shaped capacitors for homebrewing online, but my issue with these is that they're kind of impossible to cut, and it's going to require a bunch of work to actually get those holes in there and get four threaded rods all threaded together at the same time. Or actually, it's five, because you need one in the middle. And yeah, it's just not fun to make. So the commercial variable capacitor is going to have this shape, where it's kind of a plate on the bottom. Sometimes not rectangular, sometimes it's kind of the same semicircular shape. But I chose to do this in a rectangular shape because it's just simple to cut, right? But you'll see that there's like a dimple or a dip in the middle, and for the threaded rod to fit into, and I don't really understand why that is there yet. So I went with just plain old regular rectangular plate and a semicircle that doesn't have this dip in there cut in. Definitely saves me a ton of time, because I'm going to get all this stuff done pretty quickly. And when they mesh, you know, it won't be perfect, like, overlapping and all that, but who cares? If it meshes, and there's capacitance, and that's all we care about. So, if we really need to, we could do this later, but, you know, I don't think I've run into that issue yet. So, what I've done is I've went ahead and cut a cookie tin up, you know, this is the last of it, into pieces like this, kind of this size. And I could get two of them per kind of slice of a tin. So I made maybe three or four slices up each side, and I cut a bunch of these rectangular pieces up. Now these I didn't make too exact yet, because I was going to trim all the stuff down to size. So for the rectangular pieces, you kind of just go ahead and define a size and cut it, right? And I will have these dimensions that I used up at the end of the video for reference, but really these are probably not too critical. You might get a couple more puffs out of them if you cut them bigger, but generally they shouldn't matter. So here is the piece that was one of my failed pieces, but here's the idea. You just kind of round off the edges, and then you can go ahead and sand the bit of metal around the hole, or you probably want to sand that down or get rid of the paint before you drill a hole, because it just makes more sense. That'll allow the metal to contact with, you know, other threaded rod and everything else that needs to be contacted. And you're going to do the same on the other side. There's paint on here, like this one is. This is like really glossy stuff, painting it off. But eventually you will get something like this. Now you can see on the side that I have paint scraped off, like right around the nut, pretty good area of it. And the same thing happens on top, right there. After that happens, all you gotta do really is, you know, get your threaded rod, make sure these plates and holes are lined up perfectly. So what I did was I took these two plastic plates and I drilled a hole through both of them at the same time. And then right after that, right after I have these plates, these still weren't drilled. So I just kind of put these on top and I clamped this in a vise and flipped it upside down so that I will drill into this hole through this piece of metal, which guarantees that the holes are going to match up correctly. So I cut all these to shape and then I put the holes through all at the same time. So you might want to leave maybe one or two extra plates here for templates for later, but I have neglected to do that, but whatever, right? So for the template, on the templates, I have here semicircles. So I printed out a semicircle that I just really quickly threw together. Like, that hole's probably not even centered, but who cares? Just, it's a semicircle, and it will give you capacitance when you do this. You'll notice that this really isn't symmetrical either, but who cares? I just traced it on there, cut that out with a regular pair of scissors. And scissors actually work really well for this stuff. I just had a pair of these things, Harbor Freight scissors. They're pretty terrible, but they do a pretty good job of cutting through this stuff. So you want to watch out with tin snips, because tin snips, like these, I started with these. These are very good for cutting straight edges, so when you're actually cutting the lines, those straight lines over there, these tin snips were very easy and they just powered through the entire sheet metal really, really quickly. But then once you start doing like curvy stuff like that, this just ends up like crimping the metal and it bends it and it's just not pretty to clean up after. So use scissors, they work. For cookie tins, at least. And, yeah, I mean, just, you want to trace this on one of these pieces. Not all of them, just one of them. And then cut this first piece. And then, if you want this piece to match with the rest of them, just use this piece, this metal piece, to trace all the rest of these, and then cut them out with a pair of scissors like you did with the first one. So you will notice that I ended up putting a small dimple on the plates down here. And that was, at first, I was concerned about this bar just hitting the plates, because they are rather close, and I do want to maintain some sort of spacing between this bar and the plates on the bottom. I mean, at least the distance of the gap, right? Cause that would kind of make it useless if it was less, because it's going to arc over on the middle instead of on the side. So I cut a small bit, but I realized that this might be a little bit too much. You could probably get more capacitance out of this by not cutting as much out. I just kind of stuck a pair of scissors in there as an afterthought and kind of clipped off a piece, but no big deal, right? For the actual construction, it's just a plate, put two nuts, and then you do on the top a nut, a plate, nut, two nuts, and then you just continue this pattern all the way down. It's really not hard, but it took me 4 hours to do because the main issue is that these bottom plates go on really easily. Just slide on and done. But these top plates, they are very, very finicky because first of all, they're on a rotating shaft. And second of all, because they're circular and have to be oriented as the same way all the way down. So while I was doing this the first time, I was not careful in tightening all these nuts down very, very tight. And what I did was ended up doing this plate was fine, that plate was fine. And by the time I got to maybe the fifth or sixth one, I was tightening that one down, and this one just spun around and fell down, and because the nuts weren't tight, so this just spun around, and now I had to go fix that one. I had to go and try to tighten that nut, and then when that happens, the second plate falls off. So, oh my goodness, I had to take the whole thing apart and do it again. So, second time around, I did it right, and I tightened everything, like, cranked it tight. You will have to fiddle around with trying to get these plates on correctly, because they too tend to be very finicky with trying to stay upright, but eventually you do get it, and here's what results. You want to make sure that this bottom edge here, right there, lines up pretty well, so that when it's meshed, you're not going to get something like this. Like, this first plate is really bad because when you have it mesh, this actually dips into kind of the plates. So that's just extra capacitance for your minimum, and that's not good. So just watch out for stuff like that. Really, at the ends, I used nylon lock nuts. And these will prevent anything from slipping out, and it'll hold everything together pretty well. On this other side is just a piece of wire with a kind of like a ring terminal attached to the end. This was actually, I pulled this whole entire piece of wire with this terminal attached from somewhere, and it's crimped pretty well, so that works. I just slipped it on. It was a quarter inch. You might have to do a little bit of a drilling, expanding the hole a little bit on the ring terminal to get this to fit the quarter inch rod, but eventually you'll get it to fit, and this is what results. I just put another nut on this top bar and can squash that terminal in the middle. And these are going to connect right to the magnetic loop, the actual loop, the copper of the antenna. And I mean, that's really all. You probably want to use pretty thick wire. I don't know if this is thick enough. I'm not going to worry about it until it causes issues, but that's that. I did tape this because I am not sure, like, this is the spindle, this is where the motor is going to be attached to, and I wasn't sure what happens when you put 1000 volts AC onto the spindle of the motor. And I checked, this is connected to the case, and you definitely don't want your hand on there while it's transmitting, right? So, I don't know, a bit of tape might do some good. Maybe it should be grounded to something, then that would make very much sense, because, you know, it's whatever. So this tape, I checked, this is also Harbor Freight stuff. It is electrical tape rated for 600 volts. They didn't say 600 volts for what, but see, it says 600 volts, and I'm assuming that's, if you get above 600 volts or something like that, it will be able to pass through the tape. And I don't know if that varies by layer, so I put like 4 or 5 layers on here, and that should, you know, at least help in insulating my coupler from the capacitor and motor itself. This is a quarter inch rod, and I got this kind of stuff. You can see maybe on the bottom what it says, but it says, well, here it's upside down. Alright, maybe not. Maybe you can. But that is 14 to 2 AWG. So that's pretty thick wire. It'll fit over the quarter inch threaded rod no problem. And about the other size, and this motor spindle is pretty thin, I had to do some workarounds for that. But this will slip over, you can just tighten that down, and that will just spin the thing, as you can see right now. Like, I don't even have this tightened down, but this electric tape actually helps grip it also, which is good. So for this, you can just tighten this down, but then you're gonna get small issue of being off-center. So this spindle is gonna be down here, the center of the spindle is gonna be down here, while your other end, the center is gonna be up here. So my workaround for this is that I took a small piece of copper. This is actually the copper I'm gonna be using for the actual loop, and I just cut a small segment of it, enough to fit in there and also fit over this at the same time. So you'll notice that I drilled a hole straight through. You see the hole? It is 1/16 of an inch, which is the size of that hole right there. And this fits over perfectly, and you'll be able to see through the entire assembly. And essentially, I'm gonna just put a small pin into that to kind of lock this piece of copper and the metal spindle in place. So this goes in there. This is a 1/16 inch, I think, some sort of brazing rod or something like that. But it fits in there pretty snugly. And then once you have it in there, I have it matched up, just happens to match up, I guess, with the edge of the circle. So there's no way this is gonna slip out if this is pushed in all the way. So this outside diameter is roughly a quarter inch also, so that's about the same as that. And so when this slips in, notice I have these kind of like grooves in the outside. maybe you can see that. But this is gonna help grip that. This was actually an accident. While I was trying to like do this to it. This is like an expander thing where I expand the ends of the tubes. I thought maybe I could somehow get this to fit right over this threaded rod, but I guess not. It just won't work, so plan B, yay. This works. Just put it over, put that in there, and then that goes in there. And I haven't hooked up the power, I haven't tested this yet, but it should spin this thing. And I will have details on that, probably in the next video.